Buen día, buenos días. Bien, bueno, por mi parte, como coordinador, como uno de los coordinadores temáticos arquitectónicos de cabecera, deciros que estamos absolutamente...
Hola.
A dos personas que creo que nos aportarán muchísimo al curso, Sam Jacobi, thank you for coming, y Cristina Gamboa. En esta primera sesión, en este primer round de esta presencia que va a durar en realidad dos días, entre una cosa y otra, Sam Jacobi tendremos la suerte de que nos ofrecerá abierta toda la escuela. Luego por la tarde también tendremos a Cristina y a Sam de nuestro taller, y mañana Sam participará con un grupo de recerca de aquí de la CHAP en una reunión que creemos que... ¿Y esto por qué lo digo? Porque creo que, bueno, os podéis imaginar que cuesta bastante, ¿no?, poder generar esta dinámica entre universidades. Sam viene del Royal College de Londres y nos parece importante en este vínculo está Raúl Avilla, del equipo de arquitectos de cabecera, imprescindible para que estas cosas se puedan producir. Raúl está haciendo su doctorado en el Royal College, Sam es su tutor y por lo tanto era el vínculo perfecto, la llave perfecta para poder generar este encuentro. Creemos que bueno, todos podremos aprovechar esta presencia, el contenido nos va a aportar creo que una crítica interesante, una crítica externa, nueva y por lo tanto si lo que estamos haciendo aguanta o no. Bueno, yo simplemente, y bueno, y que no es poco, porque creo que ha sido muy importante, agradecer muchísimo la implicación de Enric Granell, la implicación de la escuela en poder fomentar y subvencionar este acto, y también a Marta Sogas, que ha sido una gran sorpresa encontrar que hay una persona en la CHAP que se dedica al protocolo. Y la verdad, ha sido genial poder ver cómo alguien te facilita pues que alguien desde fuera pueda venir de una manera más fácil, ¿no? Yo simplemente paso la palabra ahora a Raúl Avilla, que hará la presentación más a fondo de la persona de Sam y de su papel académico, y simplemente agradeceros muchísimo la presencia, que esto continúa a la tarde a partir de las 5:30 en nuestro taller y que mañana tendrá una continuidad ya a más petit comité en un grupo de trabajo sobre investigación que creo que será interesante. Gracias.
Hola, gracias a todos por estar aquí. Simplemente voy a introducir a Sam de forma muy breve en inglés, ya que la charla a partir de ahora pues va a ser en inglés. So thank you everyone for coming here. Thanks very much, Sam and Cristina, for joining us today. I'm going to introduce Professor Sam Jacobi, who is a chartered architect. He got a diploma from the AA, the Architectural Association School of Architecture in London, and a PhD from the Berlin Technical University. He is directing the Master MPhil in Architecture and Urban Design Projective Cities at the Architectural Association, where he has taught for many, many years in different levels, academically speaking. And now he is research leader at the Royal College of Art as well in London, when he has a research cluster there and when he is supervising PhDs. His last publications include Drawing Architecture and the Urban in 2016 and co-editor of Typological Formations, Renewable Building Types and the City in 2007. He guest edited the special journal Issues Collecting Forms in China, a contemporary review for new architecture in 2018. Type versus Typology for the Journal of Architecture, 2015, and New Design Research in Architecture and Urban Design for Urban Flux, 2015. Finally, Typological Urbanism, Projective Cities for Architectural Design, 2011. So thanks very much, everyone, for joining us, and help me welcoming Sam Jacobi to the stage, please.
Okay. Is it working? Working? Yeah, okay. Thank you so much for inviting me. It's a great pleasure to be here. Special thanks to Arquitectos de Cabecera for organizing this event. As you can see, I'll be talking about a project that's sort of loosely called Collective Forms in China. It's a research project I've been working on for several years. And it's something that was in the last phase funded by the British Academy, and we worked with the three universities in China, which were the Huazhong University of Science and Technology, Wuhan University, and Tsinghua University. Now, the project was really about, was looking at how social projects, spaces, and realities shape three contexts that I would say are critical to understanding design in China, which are the different modes of governmentality, the history of collective spatial development models in relationship to current community developments, and I will explain that a bit later. There's a shift from the idea of community or from the collective to a community, and the kind of socio-spatial changes in urban and rural developments that come along with these transformations. Now, the project really studies how a national collectivization in the 1950s, so in the Maoist era, created rural people's commune and an urban work unit systems that laid the foundations to what I would say are some of the major urban problems that you see today in China. Now, using a comparative analysis and historical approach, the project asks if a national collectivization in the 1950s continues to have a significant impact on today's urban development problems, what does this mean for understanding contemporary community building agendas and urban design practice? And a sub-question there would be, are these insights transferable beyond China into a global context of community-led developments that you can see, I think, almost without exception throughout the world? Now, the challenge of community building in China is comparable to that in many other countries, dealing with issues arising from a global move by governments, but also NGOs towards community-led projects to improve social and economic sustainability. It's a problem also closely related to that of urban design and urban governance, the process through which local governments and a range of stakeholders and cities make decisions about how to plan, finance, and manage the urban realm. Yet the challenges in China are also unique. As historically, in social, political, economic, and spatial terms, rural and urban areas were all planned, managed, and designed as a variable neighborhood scale, organized as what I call collective forms. An example of these are the rural people's commune and the urban Dunhui, and I will explain in more detail what they are. I mean, the urban Dunhui is sort of translates as a work unit that's formed by state-owned enterprises and organizations. Now, rooted in this legacy of collective forms, today's community development continues to be a regulator of economic growth and consumption. It regulates access to housing and public services, internal labor migration and social mobility and security. And this is sort of transformed version of a historical district into a modern district. And I mean, again, I will show, I'll try and explain that a bit later. Now, while there's arguably a much longer history of collective forms, I'm referring specifically to a national collectivization of all aspects of everyday life, starting in 1958 with the Great Leap Forward. However, by collective forms, I do not just mean a historical period of collectivization, but the combination of social and spatial forms shaped by collective subjectivities and the underpinning shared norms and demands to achieve shared economic and political goals and social benefits. In other words, by collective forms, I mean specific groups of people and the concrete shared spaces and activities. Thus, I suggest that collective forms are at the same time governmental forms, social forms, organizational forms, and spatial forms that often incorporate economic or political forms. I will try to explain how these collective forms differ from Western-centric abstract concepts of the public or public space or community, and raise slightly different questions of direct representation, legitimacy, social care, and responsibility. First, I would therefore like to clarify some important commonly used terms. Whereas a collective has a hierarchical organization and defined leadership, with its members submitting themselves to shared norms and demands in the pursuit of a common goal and benefits, A community is formed by like-minded individuals with shared interests who equally contribute to its self-regulation and self-administration. A collective is therefore normative. Government and governance are closely linked, and often a direct form of policing is employed, while a community is defined by its structured forms of communication and largely relies on self-governance and self-policing. Based on this distinction, it is apparent why current governments desire community development, as this permits them to hand over responsibilities for public and social welfare services and a management to grassroots organizations and institutions of civil society. In China, with all-encompassing collectivization in the 50s, not the building of individual, but collective subjectivities was fostered through a social contract that was propped up by social and work security, as well as intergenerational housing and new networks of institutions of care, something, of course, that becomes of increasing importance to the kind of societies we live in and the demographic changes we've seen. Now, the resulting collective forms and collective subjectivities are distinct from the predominant idea of individual subjectivities in public spaces found in the West. The individual in China was seen as constitutive part of a larger collective subjectivity. Yet, importantly, the relationship between individual and collective are understood in what Fei Xiaotong calls associational terms. These interpersonal associational relationships, I would argue, are formative to all social relationships and exist beyond a distinction between collective or communal governance. Thus, collective and community become conceptually and practically in governance terms less distinct in China. The Western conception comparison assumes a strong dialectic between individual and collective, a tension between individual interests and a common good that has to be continuously renegotiated with an individual subjectivity taken as fundamental to one's identity and place in society. Thus, I would say that a public space in a Western concept or conceptualization and practice does not mean a collective space, but a space of public communication, a space for individual expression while kind of addressing a larger public. Now, in contrast, collective spaces in China often just provide concrete spaces for everyday users and activities through which associations between individuals and individual, but also between individual and the collective are reinforced. This is also reflected in how these spaces are owned. The collective space is normally owned by a group of people living and working closely around it and specializes social relationships, whereas public space is typically owned by society and managed by the state on its behalf, hereby institutionalizing social relationships. Now, why does this matter? Because Western public spaces are increasingly commercialized, homogenized, and socially ineffective, with the Chinese activity-based collective space offering an important alternative framework to understanding how shared spaces can function in associational terms, and how they serve identifiable constituencies and their shared activities. Now, at the same time, current urban and rural transformations in China cannot be fully understood without the closely related context of sustained historical government policies and a parallel socialist conception and spatial design of communities, although they are equally a response to ongoing social, political, and economic transformations. Now, rapidly changing demographics and lifestyles, as well as growing land and housing marketization, have created new community typologies and new urban governance needs that define the socio-spatial development challenges. These do not always match a Western model of how urban formation, governance, and living relate. Now, in the following, I will examine both historical and current responses to these socioeconomic and socio-spatial challenges by the state, focusing on the relationship between spatial and governmental transformations. And more specifically, I want to discuss the shifts through which the socio-spatial planning in China can be understood. And these are a shift from government to governance, from collective forms to community building, and from urban versus rural to urban-rural development. Now, the first context is architecture and urban planning as a technology of what Michel Foucault calls governmentality. And I'm hereby particularly interested in the specialization of governmentality, meaning how special forms correlate to social forms or when they become a technology of government. An example of this is the Dunway, the work unit, in which architecture and spatial planning is used very legibly to support governmental intentions. This is thus closely related to the question of how a change from government to governance has created or is creating different socio-spatial developmental models. Now, this leads directly to the second context, the transformation of collective forms and subjectivities originating in the Mao era into contemporary community building attempts. And of course, since the 90s in China, there's a very strong community building agenda. I would argue that this history of collective forms anticipates some of the global tendency we see emerge today, especially a demise of the nuclear family and the diversification of household structures. A growing need for non-familial intergenerational development, coupled with a need for new social care networks of care. And of course, a close integration of work-life education, which is highly desirable, again, to knowledge-based economies. And of course, all developed economies are knowledge economies, which means all developing countries want to become knowledge economies. Now, the third context is how this history of collective forms is shaping current socio-spatial changes in urban and rural developments in China. We can see a clear historical shift from the rural to the urban, and now towards the rural-urban integration, which runs in parallel to a scalar shift of focus from large to small, both in terms of spatial planning and governance. This is closely related to the problem of providing social services and infrastructures to all citizens and in transitions from a collective to a community-based organization of the population since the 1990s. And what I will, explain later a little bit about, what you can see is there's a refocus of what the grassroots movement means in China. Now, historically, the nationally enforced Dunway in people's commune systems were exemplary in instituting a unit of total planning that provided rights and identity, but also extensive controls over the population by managing employment, housing, health and childcare, education, social welfare, and the movements of its residents. Because, of course, all social rights, all educational, all work rights are associated with the place of work and provided through the workplace. This was an ambition similar to the more radical phase of Soviet commune planning in the late 1920s, deriving from Leonid Sapsovich's economic model developed in 1928-30. The housing commune realized a Sotsgorod idea of compact socialist settlement with 40,000 to 100,000 inhabitants who worked in state-owned industrial units and farms. The Sotsgorod was divided into smaller collective and standardized housing communes with a few thousand inhabitants each. The commune was spatially separated from production units and focused on providing social services and framing the collective life of its inhabitants. Now, the project of the housing commune for the workers of the coal mine number 57 in Anzero-Sudensk by Nikolai Kuzmin from 1928-9 is a prototype of the self-contained autonomous settlement. It's an attempt to integrate communal housing and the provision of all necessary shared and public facilities within an independent superblock for 5,140 inhabitants, which are, in socioeconomic terms, defined as a working collective. The commune shapes a collective subjectivity by spatially and functionally framing daily life, by providing education, leisure and sports facilities, and healthcare. Based on an interview with miners, Kuzmin proposed a graph of life in a commune, a guide that in minutiae relates architecture to daily routines, where all private functions are relegated to minimally sized bedrooms, and mandatory super-collectivism is enforced by specializing the daily protocols of life in the provision of centrally placed collective dining halls and facilities for cultural education and socialization. So what you can see, of course, there in the kind of the commune is a social condenser that through collectivized services aims to increase economic and social productivity and free the people from the desires of bourgeois domestic life, thus creating a socialist collective subject. And it's done by, of course, reducing all private life to just sleeping accommodation. Now, Kussmann's project hereby is also an attempt to overcome what he deemed the oppressive and exploitative apparatus of the family by separating occupants by age, toddlers, children, working adults, and the elderly, especially children from their parents. With the provision of a canteen, this was to free women from the daily chores and the responsibility of bringing up children or caring for the elderly in order to become equal productive workers earning a wage. And literally, the children would sleep in different areas to the parents. Now, Kussmann's projects was one of numerous communal housing projects in the period from 1925 to 32, many of which remained unbuilt. Now, the common spatial organization was summarized by Karl Taiger in the Minimum Dwelling of 1932, a collectivist deconstruction of the traditional bourgeois dwelling, and meant to generate socialist forms of life by minimizing private individual living cells, a living room and a bedroom for each adult person, by maximizing all other functions, which were now to be collectively shared. This was to create a radically new collective housing organization and living quality for the proletariat that was not possible in a subsistence minimum provided by increasing rationalizing contemporary working housing, which modeled on the grand scale of the bourgeois apartment, had become reduced to live-in kitchen. Now, but these ideas of collective domestic living were not new. For example, Edward Neill, an advocate of the cooperative movement and a Christian socialist, proposed the concept of associated home already in the 1860s. An early built example of the cooperative household movement is the ladies' residential chambers in Marylebone in London from 1892. Now, at the same time, I would say the principles of organization is familiar from, for example, monasteries, boarding schools, or universities, which similarly have collective facilities in a strict daily schedule. Importantly, the purpose is the shaping of collective subjectivities, in this case, through education. And in the case of colleges in Cambridge, this has resulted in a unique urban fabric. Of course, it's a kind of inversion, right? The monastic inversion. What these examples show is that the kitchenless housing and public canteen, the collectivization of the economic and social functions of dwelling, the enforcing of a daily routine through collectively organized household management and services, and the dissolving of social ties defined by the extended or nuclear family in favor of work relationships were the backbone to spatializing collective subjectivities. It was a comprehensive attack on the dominant Western politics of domesticity that relied on a reinforcement and policing of the nuclear working class family as a social norm through caring professions, acting as agents of social control and the state, as Jacques Donzelot points out in The Policing of Families of 1977. Family values and family solidarity are still the keystone today to the functioning of the Western welfare state, especially in the USA, where these are supported by an alliance between free market neoliberals and social conservatives, as Melinda Cooper argues in her recent book, Family Values of 2017. Now, the Soviet communes of the 1920s and later the Chinese communes of the 1950s aimed to replace the nuclear family with a social contract that was propped up by social and work security, as well as intergenerational housing and new networks or institutions of care. Now the people's, the rural people's commune. Now the Chinese rural people's commune has several precedents. One is the Soviet kolkhoz, or the collective farm, that developed following an enforced collectivization of agriculture and extensive land reform starting in 1928 under Joseph Stalin. At its peak in 1940, 236,600,000 kolkhozes worked 78.2% of agricultural zone areas, so a very large area for agricultural production. Another example is the Israeli kibbutz, which starting from 1909 as agricultural collectives, have significantly diversified since and today account for 9% of Israel's industrial and 40% of its agricultural output. Perhaps the utopian community of New Harmony in Indiana, USA, established by the industrialist and social reformer Robert Owen, or the Falanstere envisioned by Charles Fourier in the early 19th century, can also be considered a precedent. Now, the campaign to establish people's communes in China was officially launched by the resolution on the establishment of people's commune in rural areas from 29th August 1958 as part of the Great Leap Forward. Already a month later, 23,397 people's communes incorporating 19.4% of rural households were realized. Thus, approximately 77% of China's population was part of a rural commune virtually overnight. This incredible collectivization overnight was only possible as with the proclamation of the People's Republic of China in 1949, a comprehensive land reform was completed, and collectivization of agriculture through agriculture producers' cooperatives had begun in the following year. The new communes resulted from a merging of these agriculture producers' cooperatives into larger collectives beginning in spring 1958. The aim of the People's Commune was to increase productivity and create a new social and economic, or grassroots units, as they called it, with far-reaching responsibilities for local government administration and commune management, including the coordination of industry, agriculture, finance, trade, education, military affairs, and public services. Essentially, what these communes were are autonomous grassroots movements, but in a sense of grassroots movement directly linked to the Communist Party. Now, the first of two built examples of commune settlements I would like to discuss now is the design for the Panyu People's Commune, which was published in 1959 in the Architectural Journey as one of the first pilot projects. The commune is located in Pearl River Delta in the Guangdong province. Designed for 1,787 households and a population of over 6,000 people, Panyu is an early example or model of a people's commune. As can be seen from the master plan, there are three existing villages to the north. I mean, this is it might be hard to see, but it's these three kind of natural villages to the top there. To the north of the new commune, and the agricultural land lies to the south. I don't know. Yeah. Sorry. So this part here is actually the new commune that they're proposing. Now, the scheme is divided into five sectors that follow the topography and integrate natural features, such as water bodies. These five sectors are arranged along secondary axes that run perpendicular to a primary axis spine. Each sector has clear functions, with service facilities placed right in the center and a large amount of education and cultural functions in the sectors around it. Now, for a residential settlement, disproportionately large amounts of public facilities are provided here. These include a youth center and a multifunctional public canteen, which form the centers to every functional cluster. And so in some ways, public canteens are kind of community centers, if you like. The housing is made up of two main flat topologies and a basic variations, as we can see here. So they have no kitchens or bathrooms and are not planned as family units, despite variations for 3 and 4 room units. The different residential building topologies are based on a simple combination of the two flat topologies. At the building scale, there's some shared washrooms and toilets. And what Panyu clearly shows is a symmetry between the overprovision of public facilities and the reduction of private accommodation or removal of private family space, which reinforces a collective lifestyle of working, living, and learning together. Because, of course, everything becomes synchronized from waking up, exercising, going to work, eating together, and so on and so forth, and to adult education after work. The next case I want to talk about is Shigoshan Village. Now, Shigoshan is a new village that was built in the early 1970s and represents a work brigade level in the Phoenix community with 9 work teams, which were established in 1958, so during the period of collectivization I spoke earlier about. The rural commune system lasted until 1983, when these planning responsibilities were returned to the administrative level of the township. Now, Shigoshan's population was moved there from 4 surrounding natural villages, to which many have returned since. Originally conceived as a pilot project, it is one of the very few commune settlements that still exists today. The settlement is located on a flattened hill that lies approximately in the center of the surrounding natural villages. It has a central access with a commune hall at the top and parallel rows of equally distributing housing to either side. I mean, of course, there's a slight asymmetry because there's an additional row to the left. And what you see there in green is both kind of a landscaped area, but also would include all the kind of shared facilities. This is basically how it looks today. Now, to the north, the settlement used to be a school and art college, I mean, which I think can sort of see roughly there. This is basically how the structures look today. I mean, they're basically abandoned. People still live in the village and the housing, but not they don't really use these facilities. And of course, today, what has happened is the central strip there that's been commercialized, right? So that they introduced them sort of a little bit of commercial activity. And of course, what one thing that has fundamentally changed is that the kind of strict daily routines that would be regulated in the 1970s has, of course, fundamentally changed because people are free to do whatever they want. I mean, of course, there's no more collective farming happening. There's only sort of a little bit of supplementary farming happening by the elder population because, of course, the middle generation has typically moved into cities to work. This is how the place looks like today. And so in marked in dark red is where you can see the kind of replaced housing and the new housing since the 1980s. Now, this is a typical row of the old housing. So what you can see is it's a kind of a modular system. And the organization of the housing is based on a basic module that's highlighted there in red, right? So one strip, as it were. But you can see some irregularities in between. And it's because the system or each unit is actually subdivided according to the need or the family size, right? So you have that in a way that, let's say, the service core, but of course all the bedrooms are then sort of distributed according to need. But I mean, interestingly enough, in some ways, you know, quite similar to what you guys have done. Now, unlike the example of Penyu, the housing here is entirely defined by the family and its size. But of course, this is where you can see the shift, right? In the beginning of the very early projects, trying to implement a housing model that would separate families, break up families. Here, in a way, a model that tries to accommodate and adjust to family needs, but to keep that fairly kind of, let's say, you know, equally allocated, right? So everyone has the same kind of amount of space, right? This is how these housing look like today. So what this is simply trying to say is there's this kind of efficient modular system that allows a unit variation to accommodate different family sizes, either by adding a bedroom to the right or left of the core, consisting of an enfilade of living room, storage area, and kitchen. And these variations would take account of the age of children, because, of course, older children would have to be separated from the parents, and also children had to be separated according to the sexes. And parts, of course, also if you had your parents, but basically, you know, 3 generations living together, you would also have additional room. Now, there's a similar principle of modularity, adding of rooms, bedrooms to a basic one-bed flat type or core unit. In Qigushen, unlike in Panyu, a family lifestyle is clearly considered in the design of the housing, which acknowledges varied family sizes and needs, with an average of 2 children in Qigushen, and including private kitchen. Of course, the significance here is simply that despite the one-child policy in China, in rural areas, you would have a larger I think the average was somewhere around 2.45. Now to move on and to see how does the people's commune actually transform into something like the urban Dunhui. Now, the urban Dunhui, the work unit that dominates the urban development of industrial cities in China from the 1950s to the 1990s, is in parts rooted in a communist labor movement of the 1920s and 40s. Aided by a hukou, a household registration system introduced in 1958 that coincided with the collectivization of the population and regulated labor mobility, the Dunhui strengthened a labor force defined by the native place or workplace instead of class associations. Basically, what the hukou does is, what I mentioned earlier, is the place you're registered and live in or where you're born, this is the only place you can access any kind of public services. So even if you move to another city, you will have to eventually return, you know, either for your children's education and so on and so forth. At the same time, as Ye Wenxian and the Republican origin of the Dunhui explains, the construction of a new cooperative life by the Bank of China in Shanghai in the 1930s was an important precedent to the paternalistic relationship between employer and employee that would typify the later Dunhui. Through a system of shared training and living, as well as cultural and sports activities, a collective subjectivity of employees was formed. The Dunhui had far-reaching economic, administrative, and social welfare functions, including the provision of social security through employment, housing, healthcare, and so on, right? I mean, things I've mentioned before. The socio-economic organization of the Dunhui was enabled by comprehensive provision of public and shared facilities, as well as industrial buildings for production and housing for all workers. They were essentially live-work collectives, and of course, the better the industry would do, they're working in, the more facilities and public services they will offer, and of course, better quality of housing. Now, an early example of the planning principles of the Dunhui is the plan for Xi'an University of Communication, which was published in the Journal of Architecture in 1956. It shows the principle of an enclosed, walled, and gated compound, a primary, often administrative or institutional axis, the abundance of public facilities, and standardized housing. Being a university, it especially illustrates the idea of a collectivist lifestyle through the merging of workplace and living space. Now, the next example I want to talk about is the One Iron and Steel Corporation, which is in Wuhan. Visco started to operate in 1958 in Wuhan, and it's located in its northeast. Until actually quite recently, it would still its actual profit margin would grow, but of course the number of employees would drop drastically because of a change in manufacturing. Right? It's quite recent when I think they had a major crisis and because of the steel price. Anyways, complete side issue. Now, a Dunhui can greatly differ in size, and I would say that its neighborhood scale is variable. So meaning, in some ways, I think the idea of the neighborhood scale doesn't mean the same thing as it means here, that it actually is about a walkable distance and so on and so forth. It's actually, let's say, a more organizational, infrastructural idea. So it's quite different from the community planning model of the neighborhood unit by Clarence Perry or the Soviet micro-district or micro-rayon, some example I showed you earlier. But, and it's predominantly the outcome of the size of a company or institution it accommodates, and the inclusion of public or commercial functions are equally not fixed, but depend on the wealth of the Dunhui. Now, as you can see, of course, this Dunhui is very large, so everything that you see in red is part of the Dunhui. And in that sense, this makes a Dunhui a supplyable administrative model. In the case of Visco, a major industrial Dunhui, it occupies a territory equivalent to a district. This means it has to take on corresponding administrative and social service burdens, having, for example, its own health, real estate, and education departments, and a whole range of cultural and social facilities. Because of its scale, VSCO's different public facilities are greatly distributed. It has an urban organization and large infrastructures to connect its various sectors and functions. The public infrastructures include housing and canteens, public services and amenities, including a department store, bathhouses, public transport and sports fields, theater and hospital, and a wide range of educational facilities. Now, analyzing the housing blocks of VSCO more closely, they show the typical mid-rise suburban character of semi-autonomous and walled or enclosed urban blocks that are repeated. And of course, originally, these would have been designed by the Soviets. Today, you can see how the context has dramatically changed and the outward-facing open spaces have been used to insert new buildings and facilities. But I mean, this is a typical housing block. The area I want to show in more detail here in red is a courtyard typology. Next to it, to the right, you can see a parallel of housing blocks, which is another sort of common housing typology of the Dunway. You can see here the smaller infills that exist today. So this is sort of the figure ground plan, how it originally used to work. And then these are the kind of infills that exist today. So it's made up of three different kind of block arrangements. And despite an axial disposition forming a central urban block core axis with non-housing functions that seem to link the urban blocks, what you can see is there's sort of a larger connecting axis that links one sort of cluster as a web with the next. But at the same time, I would say, sort of a flexibility between each block to create variations for different formal and functional requirements, because, of course, these are all occupied by different kind of work brigades or work teams. Now, what appears as a public open urban space are spaces that are not open to a wider public, but a clearly defined group or constituency of users that live next to it, because they're all walled and enclosed. In that sense, unlike the Western city, the urban is not formed by public infrastructural connections, but organized through semi-public private space. And what I mean by that is really, it's a shared space within a private area. These are defined by efficient housing standardization of 6 building and 8 unit types. I mean, this is just, you know, this is basically what they are. I mean, I don't think we need to go into detail. And these all use kind of variations of a limited set of the flat topologies I mentioned earlier about, so you can see the kind of different colored, you know, other different topologies and how they get repeated to form these linear housing slabs. Now, the variations of 2 and 3 bedroom units follow a sort of a legible housing space standard. However, one main difference is in the provision in most of the units of a more traditionally entry hall living area instead of a corridor, right? So all these housing units don't have a corridor. You enter into a living area and then the rooms come off there. And this standardization of housing is consistent with, let's say, the larger development of standard unit flat type policies in China's Dunway housing overall, as you can see here to the left. Now, I would argue that the Dunway, in this example, created an efficient standardization of urban block and housing that still permitted for enough variation to accommodate different shared institutions and functions. I also think that this is or was a resilient model that could deal with significant changes without losing its basic organization around defined housing blocks and defined communities. Perhaps its biggest problem is low density and problems of vehicular circulation, as the block interior is designed for pedestrians. But of course, I mean, interestingly enough, right, I mean, with the kind of conversion into these kind of super blocks here, you can actually see a scale that's equivalent to something like that, right, which of course is pedestrianized already. But also, that's actually not important. Forget it. Now, to quickly show an example of the typical transformation of Dunways, if they have not been already demolished, because of course these Dunways are located in areas now which are in central areas of cities, so very desirable high value land, you know, land values. So a lot of them have been, of course, demolished, and plus these kind of industrial industries are no longer viable. Right. Now, I want to show you a little bit of how these kind of transformations look like. And I've chosen one, this is Luoyang Research and Design Institute for Non-Ferrous Metals Processing, because it's quite a small Dunhui, and you can see this, right? I mean, this is basically how it looks like. It's one big urban block. You know, the functions are very clearly zoned, right? You can see it from the colors, so the red is the housing. So because it's a research institute linked to steel manufacturing, non-ferrous metals, right? It has a little bit of a research and production facilities, but then it also has schools and so on. But so everything, of course, as I said earlier, all the kind of functions that are needed for the employees are on site. Now, if you look at the top left corner of it, most of the housing was built originally in the 1960s and 80s. There's a typical range of unit typologies for families, right? I mean, this is how they look like, and single workers. Now, since the mid-1990s, and of course this is following the opening up policy of the economic reform in China, the Dunhui has replaced some of its housing to sell it on the open market and increase its income. Because once the industry stops, one of the only means of income, of course, is to develop your own land. But the way you develop it is you build more high-dense housing and then sell some of the housing on. Now, so what you then realize is what first simply looks like real estate speculation is therefore part of a larger problem of economic viability of a state-owned enterprise and its need to create new streams of income to support its workers, which, for example, might no longer work but are still supported by the Dunhui, because, of course, the Dunhuis are still responsible for the social welfare for them. So this is where you then start to see the kind of transformation, right, how they demolish and rebuild some of the housing. I mean, again, maybe we don't need to go through the details of the study, but what you can clearly see here is then it changes quite substantially the housing typologies or the flat typologies it produces, and it ends up to look something like that in the end, right? So typically, of course, at a high-value corner, you create the most high-rise, high-dense housing because it has most value. Right. So this is just simply to understand, right? There is a particular kind of transformation that happens, and there's an economic pressure to develop those sites. And opening up in a way to non-Dunhui members, meaning that kind of collective I spoke to in the beginning, of course, becomes diluted because also now people have the kind of right to freely move and choose where they live. Right? Whereas in the past, of course, that was all regulated. Now, what the transformation of the Luoyang Dunhui shows is a far-reaching urban change from the Dunhui to the Chaozhou, meaning a small district, in China in the 1990s to today. It created a rethinking of urban policy from a collectivization towards that of community building. It meant that the Chaozhou became the new dominant urban model and social space that replaced the Dunhui. And of course, it's very obvious, right? Because during the collectivized period, the state had a very close control over every single aspect of your life. Now, of course, they need to shift and try to understand how can you make local communities or build local communities and make them responsible, right, for some of the service provisions. Now, the Dunhuis and its gated superblocks have a direct overlap of urban neighborhoods, social space, and community governance in China. This relationship partially still exists or has realigned since the 1990s in the Chaozhou, a new neighborhood unit shaped by policies of community building. And of course, part of the problem is an administrative problem, it's a managerial problem, because whereas I showed you before that the Dunhui could almost have virtually any size, right, because it was just simply based on the work group, as it were, or the industry. Now, of course, once you actually open it up, you need to find a size of a population that can be grouped or clustered into smaller communities that can be managed, right? And this sets up an entirely different kind of governance issue. Now, what that meant is, in a very strange way, is you would have thought that with the opening up, the Communist Party would have retreated from the bottom, right? In fact, the opposite has happened. It's because, and I will explain a little bit around this why, is what you see in China is that at a small scale, in a way, in a grassroots or community scale, is there has to be much more party representation and investment in order to shift to a new kind of welfare system. Now, the decline of industrial manufacturing led in 1984 to state-owned enterprises to be relieved from the responsibility to provide welfare functions. This made a rethinking of policy and governance necessary, and this transformation can be seen in the historical and contemporary case studies we look at in China. What a study of new prevalent community-level developments through the urban Chaozhou demonstrates is the rootedness in the collective forms, as they continue to regulate access to housing and public services. But of course, they no longer relate back to work. Now, with the Chaozhou, a whole matrix of ownership and demographics emerge, which with an increasing marketization of housing moves towards privatization. There are communities that are still owned and occupied by Dunhui, some that are built by Dunhuis to relocate the populations of valuable urban sites that then can be redeveloped for profit, and completely private and commercial Chaozhous. But the majority of examples, I mean, that we looked at sort of have a mix of former Dunhui residents and external owners, because of course it's more, I mean, at least for me, it was more interesting to look at the kind of transition rather than a pure sort of market model. Yet what they have in common is that all Chaozhous continue to spatially demarcate and define a clearly identifiable community and its members. And of course, anyone you would ask in China, what community do you belong to? They will understand this as a physical question, right, where they actually live. Right? So that's quite interesting. This is because a community is still, first of all, in China, an administrative space or governing unit according to whose size, wealth, and demography, social services and rights are provided exclusively to its residents. This can be clearly seen in the administrative and spatial organization of today's urban developments, and examples we studied include the Hongmei Chaozhou in Shanghai, like this, or the Miaosan Chaozhou in Wuhan, and the Geguan Chaozhou in Wuhan, and Xinyun Shili in Beijing. Now, I mean, basically, we looked at, you know, in three different cities, sort of typical examples. But it's also very evident in these examples is this kind of new standardization of housing, or a different kind of standard of housing. And the rights, the services and rights associated with each Chaozhou are legitimized either by historical or continued Dunhui relationships, or bought in private Chaozhous, which tend to have better range and quality of services. Well, this is in fact what they refer to as charities or NGOs, right? There's actually, you know, these kind of organizations that will provide these types of services. In all other cases, which is the vast majority of cases now, the state steps in to provide the services, creating a costly, large-scale challenge to rationalize provision. And as you can see, every single Chaozhou has a service center. Right? I'm sorry, it's a bit small, but it's sort of highlighted there in red. This is all service center. A service center, let's say, is a little bit like a community center that provides basic services, support services to its local residents. Right? So now you have to imagine every single neighborhood in that scale has one of those, and all of those that are not privately run have to be run and financed by the state. Now, in the Chaozhou community, self-governance, state representation, and social public services continue to be strongly linked and define a community. Therefore, communities are also still defined by the rights to social services, care, and infrastructures, including housing. This is an interesting point for comparison, considering that European countries are increasingly trying to reestablish this relationship between community and social care. Looking at a typical urban governance structure in China, there's a hierarchy from the city level that in the case of Wuhan, a tier two city serves 10.9 million people, to the district level, which in the Hongan district has a population of over 1 million people, to the sub-district level, which in our case of the Guangchun sub-district has a population of 283,000. So the district level is a little bit smaller than, I guess, the smallest area, the central area of Barcelona. What you can see in gray is a community level, a basic autonomous or grassroots organizational level, or what they refer to as grassroots, right? And I mean, again, what's to me interesting about this is represented at that level is the community, the house owners, and the state. The community is typically made up of several chouchus, for which it might have different levels of administrative responsibility, as can be seen sort of in this slide here. Now, while community governance varies from city to city, in general, its administrative level is a residence committee in which party and community representation overlap. Therefore, despite growing privatization, the Chinese Communist Party had to ingrain itself at a much smaller scale and to a much larger extent. In addition to the residence committees, most chouchus have a property management company responsible for managing maintenance of public areas and facilities, and an owners committee where these contain private housing. What this diagram shows is that within this community governance structure, there's a mixture of party representatives, community representatives, elected and employed community members, as well as community volunteers that work together to maintain a social network of support and care. I would argue that despite obvious conflicts and problems, for community-controlled developments to have legitimacy, some state involvement and a clear accountable governance structure is necessary, as it exists to some extent here, unlike in other places like the UK. But of course, there are other kind of issues around the quality of services that are being provided. You know, and of course, yeah, I mean, there's a whole range of issues. Now, I would now like to briefly describe how collective spaces are used in the chouchu. The appropriation of collective spaces is at times contradictory, as individuals often claim unhindered large part of it, as in the case of illegal private structures and extensions, an example of which is shown here at the top left. What you see below this are examples of illegal commercial uses and structures that either provide services to the communities, such as repair shops or a health salon, or are for consensual shared use by residents, such as an ad hoc open air lobby in front of a residential building entrance. The next column shows spaces designed for collective use. On the top, again, a private appropriation, with a walkway and outdoor gym being used for the drying of peanuts, and a space in front of a building taken over by the occupant of a ground floor flat and his private belongings. Below this, you can see a playground used exclusively as a social space by adults without their children, and a leisure pavilion used by mahjong players or just for relaxation. The final column shows collective spaces in the form of buildings. First, a service center, with the two images below showing a typical service counter and an activity room. And below this is a commercial center that, although sitting within a chouchu, is predominantly used by external visitors. And of course, why these kind of different forms of appropriation also happen is because land ownership is quite different historically in China, because, of course, all urban land was reappropriated and is state-owned. Right, so the closest, of course, was this when the Dunhui moved in. It was owned collectively by the Dunhui, or today it's leased to developers on, you know, different periods of time. But it means this private ownership as such has never historically existed. I mean, that's why you won't really find private land in cities. Now, the matrix starts to show how associational relationships I spoke about earlier are established and maintained through planned or appropriated collective spaces that have a concrete and distinct, yet also unstable relationship between constituencies, space, and ownership and use. It is therefore possible that collective spaces are both supportive and contradictory to our understanding of a communal space, as they are equally used for individual and shared purposes. To say it differently, while public spaces are normally protected from appropriations, especially by individuals, what we see here is a negotiation of small-scale appropriation, a process that is, I would argue, essential to associational relationships and community building. Given the decline of large-scale projects and a refocus on a smaller scale of design, planning, and governance in China, it is not a coincidence that this is creating a new types of young design practices that are interested in issues of community building. For example, Met Office, an office we kind of collaborated with, has taken a very different approach to its community renewal of the Xinyuan Chile community in Beijing, which was one of our case studies. Based on a comprehensive study of the site and its socio-spatial needs, they defined strategic small interventions throughout the site, which led them to developing an intervention toolbox instead of a master plan. This acknowledges the need for an urban design whose implementation can be negotiated between stakeholders instead of presenting a final outcome. This also matches new community design ambitions, as evident in the recently published Technical Guidance of Working Mechanism and Design for Community Planning in Wuhan, which sets out the policy context, stakeholders' involvements, and decision-making processes to develop a community plan. Because, of course, the issue is you need to move this away from just a community party organization, right? You need to open it up to actually for, we would call it civil society engagement, but of course this is not how they would call it in China. Now it highlights in its flow diagram that community planning is a socio-spatial problem and that we cannot understand urban design just as concerned with designing a built environment, but it is also a problem of designing a social environment. Urban design therefore must consider both social and spatial policies and practices. It is especially for urban designers important to better understand how a contemporary collective space in China developed as essentially a shared space of everyday activities. Despite similar appearance, it differs in conception and function from a Western public space and its reasoning as an abstract public sphere in a political sense. When the idea of a Western public space was introduced in China in the mid-1990s, it's largely disregarded this historical difference to existing collective spaces. Instead, it arrived with the introduction of urban design by Chinese planning authorities, which had the aim to create a focus on design and a layer between architecture and planning capable of mediating the integration of communities and their needs into large urban plans. As I said before, many of the spaces designated as public spaces are simply open spaces for the use by local residents. They are not the same social space as a public space. Why this is important is because a critical role of urban design is to establish spaces for shared, or rather differentiated, collective use. Often the public spaces that derive from a Western terminology of urban design, however, can be overly symbolic and fail to give due consideration to concrete activities and constituencies, which is essential to effective community building. This has to be based on a clearly defined group of users and their everyday needs. Given some contradictions on how collective, communal, or public spaces are commonly understood, it is not surprised that imported Western design models and notions of placemaking and local communities have not always translated well into China. Even at a more basic level, the definition of scale and the urban is inconsistent. Urban design is therefore mostly seen in China as serving planning and preparing urban plans for real estate development, something, however, that is currently changing. The failure to fully understand how urban design designs relation to socio-economic and political aims reveals also a limitation of its traditional multidisciplinarity of architecture, planning, and landscape architecture, as defined in the 1960s in the US, I think is quite an important one. Therefore, a better integration of urban sociology, social policy, and spatial planning is needed to cross-establish disciplinary, methodological, and cultural boundaries. And there has to be a stronger link between different scales of design, with a shift towards a small scale already evident in the focus on community renewal projects in China. Now, to provide, let's say, a preliminary conclusion based on our studies, I would make the following claims. First, communities are still defined by the social services and infrastructures they provide to their members. This is an important heritage of collective forms from the Mao era and of great value to global community debates. It raises a question of how this can better adapt to demographic transformations, changing social care needs, and cultural diversification. Second, communities continue to have strong administrative functions. The governance as grassroots organization include a diverse mix of state and community representatives, but also state and community paid employees and service providers. The state is directly part of communities. This gives it political and social legitimacy and potentially the specialized knowledge and skills needed to develop community plans, but of course also leads to conflicts. Despite far-reaching challenges, there's some resilience in the governance structure and the new types of collective spaces they produce, which other countries could learn from. And of course, I mean, I also, of course, speak to this as coming from the UK background, where, of course, the UK government had a very long history of neoliberal policies, meaning they would disengage with any kind of small-scale development. Interestingly enough, now they've been, over the last couple of years, investing £60 million a year to foster community-led housing, because it's not something they can or want to deliver, right? But you can see the kind of shifts that comes from different for different reasons, most of them being economic. And now, part of the problem, I would say, is that in the UK, at least, is once you talk about communities to take on these responsibilities, who are these communities and who represents them? You know, this is what I mean by what's the legitimacy of communities to actually make a claim. Now, third, collective spaces are not public spaces. They are associational, at least in a Chinese context. The relationships to user and activities are concrete, not abstract. The ownership is more collective than institutional. Individual and shared claims to collective spaces can be contradictory but coexist. And the appropriation often strengthens associational relationships between individuals and individuals, but also individuals and the collectives. Now, fourth, urban design has to simultaneously consider spatial and social environment practices and policies. A new multi-scalar, a new interdisciplinary approach is needed that enables multiple stakeholders and disciplines to have a say in the design process. Architecture and planning remain hereby important as an instrument of spatial governance, but the relationship between its representation and agency has to be further clarified. I believe that the urban development in China challenges some of the Western preconceptions on community and urban governance. For example, terms such as the public space, and placemaking have no history here or mean something quite different. It puts into focus the question if housing is a commodity or right, or how cooperative housing, lifestyles, how work and education relate, and asks how we design not for public but for shared activities by non-constituencies. As I have discussed, there are different traditions and histories to the nuclear family idea of domesticity and individual subjectivities, which increasingly become important with demographic change and the demise of domesticity, and to which we as architects and urban designers must respond to. Thank you very much. I don't know if there's any time and I should take any questions.
Are there any questions? Now we have a little bit of time for a debate, if there's anyone who want to raise any kind of question. So I'll make the first one. Which are the incentives of these grassroots organizations to participate in political life, actively speaking? Like at some point you yeah. showed there were like some people who were elected, some people who were hired to develop that work professionally, and then voluntary. Yeah. So how does this come to happen in a place and in a time?
I mean, they typically all are party members, right? So because they're party members, they, you know, they're required to improve themselves, and it's part of the ethos, right? But because that comes with a lot of its own problems, right? Because of course, it's motivated, but it's politically motivated at that kind of level, and of course they're trying to move away from it, mm-hmm. right? And of course, it's a huge problem. How do you move from a model where the government almost provides everything to a model where civil society, which is a non-word in China, right, will take on some of those responsibilities. So this is a huge struggle they have, right? I mean, how do you, right? So at the moment they're going through a phase where when they call us teaching responsibilities, right? I mean, how do you get communities to take on these kind of responsibilities that typically would be given by the state?
there's sort of a pedagogical function in the state, like encouraging people to participate. But I guess, on the other hand, they also are expecting some kind of answers or not.
Sorry?
Like when the government is encouraging people to participate in this kind of housing procurement, are they expecting some kind of answers, or are they giving totally freedom for these communities to organize themselves?
Well, they're never entirely, you know, making these decisions on their own. Well, because it's, you know, because the whole governance system is well, the government. But okay, this is where it's slightly more complicated, right? I mean, the let's say the lowest level of government is the sub-district level. Now these communities are smaller. That's why they call them grassroots organizations. So they're officially not part of the government structure, but you have government representation there, and people pay there. Right? But I mean, I have to say, so it comes with its whole, you know, problematic issues, right? To me, what was quite interesting, though, is to see how I think government is involved at that scale and actively involved, right? And they're trying, I mean, there's also, in some ways, experimental, I think is the wrong word, right? But I mean, they are trying to better understand how to change the system, because, I mean, their motivation, of course, is like anywhere else, cost. You know, it's an incredible burden to, you know, staff and manage all these areas. And of course, it's also the pressure, you know, they know, you know, demography is changing. They need to provide better services. They need to provide services much more in a way, in an open way, right, that you know, more people have access to. So, you know, so because, right, before it was a very closed system where everything was self-managed anyways. Now suddenly you get actually a system where everyone is free to move around and potentially take on services wherever they are. So how do you structure that? Right, so it's an incredible challenge.
Any questions in the audience?
I was always thinking, when you were showing your images of this kind of collective spaces that you are trying to explain or trying to understand, I was always thinking if these collective spaces, most of the time when you are analyzing them, they are kind of in the open space or in the space between the buildings most of the time. And I was always thinking that, for example, from our like Western or European view, this collective space, as you say, it always could be like inside the building, probably as a link between the public, totally public space, and the private or the living space. So I was always wondering if that is like kind of a mix between like your examples that you were showing, that they were always like zoning, like the dwelling, the school, the park, and another level that could be like the mixticity, like inside the building, that you have like all this grade of zonification, including the collective spaces. I think that, like, what was around my mind all the time, that probably I don't get in, like, finding examples.
I mean, of course, it's not so straightforward, right? Because if it were, we would all, you know, design these kind of spaces quite easily, right? So I think, I guess, one anomaly to start off with is, what I try to say is, the kind of idea around the public doesn't exist historically like that, right? Because of course everything is enclosed, right? The Dunway model is, of course, is a gated community model. We would call it a gated community. Now, so what you understand is actually most of the things is actually a nuance between some form of a privatization, as it were. Right? We would call it privatization, which is not probably the right term to use. But I mean, this is what I'm saying is it's a kind of a collective space. It's actually also literally in many cases. You know, for example, in rural areas, because the land ownership system is different, you as a rural community own all that land shared. And the rights you have are actually just land use rights. Okay. Right? So you get to use things for, you know, for a certain period of time. But that means, right, you as a group own everything. Right? So it just becomes nuanced. Right? So even if you enclose your plot of land, in some ways, yes, it's yours, but it also isn't. Right? It's actually the one that, you know, everyone belongs. Now, if once you translate into an urban area, of course, it becomes a little bit more complicated, right? Especially once you start opening these areas up. But that's a particular kind of, let's say, spatial social history that exists in China, right? Which I think is quite different. But I think that's just quite interesting, where, you know, we think about the public as actually something that everyone has a right to access, everyone has a right to use. And these ones don't, right? They're actually always in some form enclosed. Even if you can walk in, okay, it is typically still enclosed, and it's still actually, you know, someone has a, you know, you belong to it in a way. Now, this is not to say that this is a better model, yeah, right, or this is a better idea. All I'm saying is it is a very different kind of socio-spatial history that has produced its own kind of relationships, right? And I think quite often we come to a place and say, this is the way it should be, because everything should be public, for example, right? Because we think public is good, it translates into good. Or, you know, so, you know, sometimes what was interesting to me, my interest in that was just to really understand is what happens if you don't really have an idea of the public? How do these things work, right? So, of course, historically, see is quite an oppressive, of course, nature of, you know, telling everyone what they have to do when. No, but you still get some of these kind of issues still today, right? Because there is actually shared responsibility, as it were, in providing things, right? And at the moment, of course, it's still the state is involved, but of course, the larger question is what happens once they move, and of course, it could fail.
Any other question?
Hi, I was wondering how the capitalism and the social classes that appear along with it are interfering with this kind of community organization, and when there is a power of renewal of neighborhoods and probably there's people coming that are wealthier than the others, how this interfacing in communities is creating, right, new relations or new community links.
Yeah, I mean, I guess this is like anywhere else, right? I mean, I guess this is what a cause of diversification is. Of course, the largest shift in China is the internal migration, right? So it's actually the rural population coming into cities. That's what they predominantly experience as the other, right? I think there, of course, like anywhere else, there's no agreement, right? Of course, they don't want migrants. Or in many areas, they don't want migrants, right? So they go into the more rundown, dumber areas, and so on and so forth. Right? So I don't think they're trying to integrate it so much yet. I think that, you know, there's some questions around it, because of course, I mean, this is what I also mentioned around the hukou, because you're so sort of restricted in your movement. They're now trying to open this up and to reform that. So if you do economically more established in an urban area, you can actually change your hukou and kind of entitlement to services. So there is this kind of attempt to reform those relationships, right? But I mean, I think what's interesting to me at least is these relationships. Well, let's put it this way. I think in Western countries, our relationship to the state are in a way us as an individual to the rights we can claim from the state as large, right? I would say in China, to me, what's interesting is the rights you have, right, or the kind of claims you make around services and so on, they're actually somehow spatialized, right? There's actually a physical area associated with where you get these things. I know this is not really the answer to your question, right? But I think that's the kind of interesting problem, right? And now, of course, one of the things they need to also deal with is how do you, you know, manage that when the kind of homogeneity, as it were, right, is lost, right? If you have actually very different people. Now, of course, in real terms, what simply happens is those people with better means will just move into better property and private property. Right, so if you do well, I mean, you just move into a private compound, right, that has a modern gym and so on. But of course, I think the irony is the ones who can afford to actually move into, let's say, high-end, more luxury housing areas, they wouldn't use the facilities either, because they will just go anywhere, somewhere else, because they're even better. Right, so you get that whole kind of weird shift. So the ones that don't have the services, they want them, but they can't have them. And the ones that have them, they want the other ones. So, you know, there's a whole kind of complexity, I think, still around how you provide the right services at the right location.
Yep.
Hi. How far do you think the path dependency is built on the forms of governance and also the urban forms that are historically characterizing yeah. China in comparison to Spain are relevant when addressing collectivity today? I mean, independently to the forms of governance today.
Yeah. So you're asking how closely they're connected.
No, I'm asking how far you think the historically forms of governance and translated into urban form are relevant when implementing collectivity today.
Oh, okay, yes, sure. Part of the reason why I looked at China is because I think it's particularly legible what happens, right? Because you can see that very clearly. And it's because you can see the governance structure very clearly, right? Because it's there physically. If you walk into any of these areas, you know, you can shake the hands, right? This is you know, governance representation. Now, of course, you know, Spain, you know, European countries, that has changed over a very long period of time, right? And most of the representation, of course, I mean, we don't have really that kind of state representation, right? I mean, I don't know the last time I've really seen any, I guess, sort of state representative in any of these countries, right? So I don't think it's so important to go that far back, right? I mean, well, I guess to me, the reason looking at China, is, as I said, is you can see that very clearly, and I think it reveals to me at least some of the issues, right? Is because I think in some ways is the lack of state representation is also what has been sort of compensated for by the kind of community representation, right? And I'm not saying it's good or bad. All I'm saying is, you know, is this the best way of managing these things? And, you know, do we get the right things out of them, right? Because in some ways, right, and of course this is also in some ways where I think it comes through political ideology is embedded into that, right? Because we think that in a Western democracy, to have direct community representation is a good thing, right? And, you know, I mean, again, I'm not saying it's a bad thing. All I'm saying is, do we release also governments from the responsibilities they hold? Right, but because we're stepping in and we're saying, okay, this is great, right? This will, you know, foster civil society to take on these kind of responsibilities, and it is a good thing. But at the same time, I think we're also forgetting that governments, or at least that's what I think, states, they are responsible for a lot of these services, right? And they should contribute, right? So yes, I mean, I think it's not so that we need to, I think, look at the history, you know, that the history. I think so much a historical context is important, more to understand why are we actually responding in particular ways, and are there other ways of responding to it? Maybe to say it this way.
Final question, maybe? Okay, I guess we can leave it here. Thank you very much, Sam.
Thank you very much.